Hello everyone, it's Gail from Ticket to Anywhere, and welcome to the latest edition of Friday Fragments, which is a meme hosted by James over at bookclubchic.blogspot.com. And in this meme, we are encouraged to vlog a reading excerpt, yes, that's it, that's the word I'm looking for, of one of our current reads, or just one of our very favorite books. I had a very difficult choice this week as I'm reading a couple of different review books, but the book I chose to read is called Blindsided by Drusilla Cummings. This is a book I had not heard about at all before I bought it, and I mainly bought it because it just sounded so very interesting in the store over the weekend. And it is the story of a girl named Natalie. She is 14 or 15 years old, and she's just a young girl in high school, and she has glaucoma, and for many years she's been slowly going blind. And this year, where this book starts off, she's actually been sent to blind school by her parents because the doctors say that there's little to no hope anymore for ever recovering her eyesight, and so she must learn how to cope. And the back of the book has a great tagline that says, "Newly blind, Natalie must make the decision whether to embrace life or live scared." So the excerpt that I am going to read to you is from a scene during one of her classes at the school. And kind of is a good scene because it really shows where she is mentally. So this chapter is called The Worst. Unbelievable. On the second floor of Norland Hall at the Baltimore Center for the Blind, a whole walk-in closet full of canes hanging on hooks surrounded Natalie like a stalactite nightmare. Natalie heard the voice repeating, "Find the one that fits," but her hands froze and the voice echoed in her head. Definitely, absolutely, the worst thing so far, she thought. Forget the weird kids and a braille lesson where she learned that there are 6 dots in a braille cell, and that different combination of dots stood for different letters. A single dot, a bump, or bump was A, while B, C, E, I, and K all had 2 dots, but each set of dots was arranged differently. Impossible! How in the world were a bunch of bumps ever going to mean something? But by far, the cane was her greatest fear because of all it represented and all it would strip away, like her freedom, her anonymity. They might as well hang a sign around her neck, too. Pathetic blind person. "Natalie, go ahead, hon," urged the woman who was Natalie's new cane instructor. "Lift a cane off the wall and see if it's the kind you want." But Natalie didn't want a cane. She didn't need a cane. What would her friends think if they saw her right now? Would she even want to tell Meredith about this? The instructor, Miss Audra, patiently repeated the instructions. "Choose one," she urged. She was a young teacher. From what Natalie could see of Miss Audra, she was petite, probably no taller than Natalie herself, and Natalie had glimpsed a long braid down the instructor's back. "Select one and see if it's the right length," Miss Audra prodded. Natalie reached out, her fingers quivering, hesitating, because she didn't want to touch a cane, let alone use it. Finally, she grabbed one, yanked it off the hooks so fiercely that she knocked several of the canes onto the floor with a loud clatter. "Don't worry, we'll pick them up later," Miss Audra said, unfazed by the noise and the mess. "Focus on the cane in your hand, Natalie." Natalie tapped the cane on the floor, a little too hard probably, and could tell it had a stationary pencil tip, as opposed to the canes that had a little wheel that rolled when the cane moved side to side. "Is that the kind you want?" Miss Audra asked. "Want? I don't want a cane," Natalie screamed silently to herself. "All right then," Miss Audra's voice maintained its calm despite the lack of response from Natalie. "Let's see if it's the right size. Stand up tall, Natalie. Shoulders back and hold the cane in front of you. Closer. That's it. What did we just talk about? If it's up to your breastbone, up to your armpit, it's the right length. What do you think?" The cane was slightly higher than her waist. Must be for a midget, Natalie thought a bit snidely. Or a small child, she realized. "No," Miss Audra said when Natalie maintained her silence. "It's not the right one for you, is it? It's way too short." Natalie fumbled around for another cane. Feeling bumps along its length, she could tell it was one of the folding types, which most students had. The tip was straight, no roller, and it came up to her armpit. How about that one? Miss Arja asked. Natalie nodded, barely, but her heart was pounding and the blood throbbing in her templates. If she learned how to use that cane, there was no going back. She would be giving in, admitting to the problem, opening the door to lonesome blindness. Afraid, she squeezed her eyes shut, trying to block out how it would look and what it would mean. All right then, that's your cane. It has three parts, the grip, the stem, some people call it the shaft, and the tip. When we're finished today, take this cane back to your room. A lot of the kids put something on the handle, the grip, to identify it as theirs, a ribbon or some yarn, a keychain maybe. Identified as hers? Natalie almost laughed. No way. And please, Miss Audra emphasized, keep the cane in a special place in your room, Natalie. Always in the same place, so you know where it is. When you have O&M, orientation and mobility class, you need to bring it with you. She lost it. She'd be glad, Natalie thought. Now, Miss Audra continued, a cane is really just an extension of your finger, a way of telling you what's coming up. Let's have you put the sleep shade on and get out into the hall and try it. But when Miss Audra handed Natalie the spongy black mask, Natalie drew the line. She did not want to blind herself with the shade and take the cane into the hall and try it. She certainly did not want to take the cane back to her room and find a special place for it. Tears welled in Natalie's eyes and spilled down her cheeks. Natalie, what's wrong? Miss Audra put an arm around Natalie's shoulders and guided her to the chair. Here, sit down, please, talk to me. Natalie sat and held the sleep shade in her lap. What is it, Natalie? It's just that. I don't want a cane, she said finally. I don't want to learn how to use it. Why not? Why not? Natalie swung her head around and screwed up her face, repeating the question as though Miss Audra was crazy to ask it. Yes, why not? Because I'm not blind. Because I don't need a cane. Because I don't want to lose my freedom. Lose your freedom? Miss Audra didn't miss a beat. Yes, Natalie insisted, frustrated that Miss Audra didn't seem to understand. The minute I use that cane, people will look at me like, whoa, she's disabled. But Natalie, I don't want people looking at me like I'm weird, like I'm a freak. Natalie put a hand up to her mouth, surprised at herself for saying those things out loud. What a hypocrite. What was happening to her? Wasn't it Natalie who wanted the student council to convene a special panel of the handicapped students back at Western Allegheny High School so they could educate other kids about their disabilities? She had worked hard to keep in each one of those students, Peter Maxwell, who used a wheelchair, Claire McDermott, who is deaf, and Brittany Tedesco, who had dyslexia, to take part. Each of them had finally agreed to sit at a table as a panel and pass their microphone to answer questions and talk about their disabilities. Natalie had arranged the whole thing, and here she was calling those great kid freaks. The shame of it quashed over her anger. And in silence that followed, Natalie dropped her head. Miss Audra paused before continuing in her steady voice. Surely you know what the report says about your eyesight, Natalie. In the event that you lose the rest of your vision, we want you to be ready. That is why you're here, so you can will have some skills when the day comes. If the day comes, Natalie interrupted. Okay, if the day comes. So you aren't totally helpless. She paused. You don't want to be helpless, do you? No. Natalie slowly shook her head. She did not ever want to be helpless. She was already helpless enough. Miss Audra touched one of Natalie's knees. Then let us prepare you, Natalie. Let us give you the skills you will need in case that day comes. She sounded so earnest, so sincere, that Natalie wanted to soften, but she couldn't. Who is your doctor, Natalie? Someone in Baltimore? No, Natalie replied. It's Dr. Rose in Rockville. What did Dr. Rose tell you, Natalie? Natalie began chewing on her bottom lip. She didn't want to repeat or even think what Dr. Rose had told her, because that's when it really started, the big change inside, the panic, the fear. Suddenly the phone rang, a rude intrusion, and Miss Audra touching Natalie's knee again. Would you excuse me for a minute, Natalie? I've been waiting for that call and I need to take it. I won't be a minute. Natalie quickly nodded. Then as soon as her instructor walked away, Natalie stood up and bolted from the room. So that's a small section of Blindsided by Priscilla Cummings. And I think it's a really cool book. Like, the title has the word blindside written in braille underneath, kind of in the raised bumps. And it's truly remarkable that, you know, people can actually learn to read from those. What's also cool about this book is at the very back, it actually has the braille alphabet listed out. And again, very, very, very impressed when I see this, that people actually are able to learn and read from the bumps in the books, and they do it so effortlessly. And so, again, that was Blindside by Priscilla Cummings, and I just think it's a remarkable book so far, and it sheds light onto just an aspect that kids, teens, adults, and so many people deal with that it's not really talked about in books. So go look for it. I don't think you'll regret it.